We've all heard nightmare stories about artists working with clients, but the truth is there are amazing stories too that we want to share. So today we're going to walk you through our customer journey and how we work with clients directly so that you can craft a killer experience for your customers too. I'm Alana and this is my business partner Katie, and we are two artists on a mission to help other artists pursue their creative passions and make more money doing what they love. In today's video, we're going to break down our client workflow, how we work directly with clients one-on-one, and what process we bring them through. Here's a fun fact. Katie and I have yet to meet in person. The world was shook in 2020, and so our plans to meet fell through. But the thing is, we haven't met most of our clients either, so we had a couple tips and tricks up our sleeve for working together just virtually. If you're a freelance artist doing branding or photography, or if you're doing wedding stationery, all of those things can be done virtually, but it's really important to make sure your customers still feel heard and connected to you throughout that process. Katie and I are both hand lettering artists, and we've done freelance projects over the years, ranging from magazine covers to patterns for bike shorts. So we've learned a lot about the range of products and how to work with clients effectively. Of course, each project brings its own set of unique challenges and allows us to stretch our creative muscles in new ways. So the first thing is, how do clients actually find us? Where are they finding us, and how's that initial contact going? A lot of clients find us online, whether that be through social media or even a Google search where we might pop up in their results. But they also find us a lot through referrals. So that might be a friend telling someone they worked with us, or someone saying, I heard about this person, and referrals are definitely one of our favorite ways to get found. Whenever I get an inquiry, let's say it's on Instagram or another app, I always try and move it over to my inbox, because my inbox is where I keep everything organized and it really helps me stay on top of my to-do list. If someone's willing to take that extra step and send something to my email, I know that they're more serious. So once we start talking via email, I want to figure out if this is a good fit for me and if I'm a good fit for them. If I'm not a good fit, I always try and give them a referral to someone else or a place that they can look for someone else. So the first two questions I like to ask them are, do they have a timeline that they're working within, and what is their budget? This helps me not waste their time or my own trying to answer and learn more about their project if it's just not a good fit from the beginning. Once I've determined that it's a good fit, I'll schedule a call with them so I can hear their voice and hear a bit more about their story and their project. It's really important for me, if someone is making an investment, that I really understand them and the way that they work best. So hopping on that phone call for me really helps me to kind of put all the puzzle pieces together. I know a lot can get lost in translation via email, and getting on the phone can be a little bit scary for some people, but I've really found that it helps break down some of those barriers and helps me feel much more connected to the client. So here are a couple things I like to accomplish on that initial phone call. The first thing is, I like to make sure we're on the same page. We both understand what I do, what they're looking for, and that those align. The next thing is, I want to make sure I understand the goals and the expectations of the project. I want to make sure I really understand what their final deliverables will look like, how it's going to be used, and exactly what they're hoping to get out of working with me. I also like to know if they've done a project like this before, so I can kind of gauge if they have experience working with freelancers, or if this is totally new to them, and how much handholding or advisement they might need throughout the process. This call usually lets me understand who they are as a person a little bit more, which will help me with one of my favorite tips a little bit later down the line. One of the questions I ask on my inquiry form is, what's your favorite candy? Because for me, I love candy, so it's something we can relate about, or it's something that I could use as a client gift later on. Once I have enough information about the project, I will take some time, a couple days, to work on a pitch deck. I'm not doing any creative design work until they've signed the contract and paid their deposit. This is just me reiterating and putting in a really nice presentation what we've already talked about, and this is sort of my pitch. This is me writing them back and saying, here's exactly what's included, here's the inspiration you talked about. It's just reiterating all of that information so that they know I was listening. The idea of putting a pitch deck together for every inquiry seems like a lot of work, but that's why I do that initial phone call, is so that I make sure I'm only doing a pitch deck for the clients who are very serious about working with me, and already I know that their budget aligns with mine. I find that this really helps the client understand my process and how I work as well, because it's something tangible they can look at and refer back to, and it really helps wow them. And one of my favorite tricks for this is using a template. I used to custom design every deck, but now I just use a deck on Canva, or if I have one I've already done, I'll just open that back up, and I find this saves me hours of work. I like Canva, even though I could use InDesign or Illustrator, because it's already done for me and I just have to drag and drop and fill in the information. You could even have a VA or someone who works on your team fill in this information if they were on that discovery call with you too. over the years, I've done a lot of experimenting and a lot of changing my deck. So make sure you take the time to figure out what would work best for your customers and for you and your creative process. Once I've got that green light on that pitch deck that I've sent over, I will work up their final contract. And I use the contract kit for artists, which is something that Katie and I have created. I will link it down below. We worked with our lawyer to create these because we were doing several different types of projects and always reinventing the wheel every time a project came. So instead, we created four templates that we use, and I will pick the right one, and I'll take about 20 minutes to fill in their information and update the project scope before sending that over to the client. Now, I'll send this over for a digital signature, either via DocuSign or HelloSign, because I don't want it to be held up waiting for them to sign it, print it, scan it. I want them to be able to sign it on the go and say, I'm ready to work with you. Once I've got that signed invoice, I will send them a deposit, which I will send via QuickBooks or whatever software I'm using, and I will wait to do any work. Do you understand? No work until you have that deposit. I usually take a deposit for projects that are over $600. And under $600, I just make sure I have that signed contract saying that they will be paying at the completion of the project. But depending on your price point, you'll figure out what works best for you. Another thing about payments is that I always give my clients the option to pay in installments if it's over $600. I understand that this is a big investment, especially for a small business, and I want to make sure that they are able and confident when they work with me. So the next thing I do is create a timeline, and I am a productivity nut. I love a calendar and a to-do list, so I will go through and I will add all of our timeline dates on my calendar so that I know exactly what to work on every day or every week. I also put all of that information into Trello or whatever to-do list or CRM program that you're using so that I know exactly what tasks I have to work on. I always break up my biggest tasks into smaller tasks so that I know exactly one task I can work on, let's say it's for an hour or for a day, before I start tackling those big things. There are a ton of CRM programs out there you can use, like Asana, Trello, Notion. There are so many, and I've tried a bunch of them, and I really like a handwritten note. I keep a lot of notepads on my desk, but I also love my Google Calendar, and right now I'm using Trello and really enjoying it for our workflow. You can choose if you think it'll be helpful to onboard your client onto Asana or whatever program you use as well, depending on if they need it or you don't think it will be helpful. I tend to keep my clients very separate. That works for the type of projects I do. So I keep those projects and those tasks internal for me on Trello, and they don't see any of it. So when I'm ready to send over designs, I send over another deck. This one is much simpler. I just do a PDF with my options in it, and I typically like to get them on the phone so I can work through those designs with them and explain my thought process. If there's more than one design, I find this is really helpful because they can reference a page or, oh, the one on the left or the one on the right, instead of just sending six different JPEGs or something like that. I think it makes you look really professional when you send it in a cohesive brand presentation. If you were in a board meeting with them, you would show them a presentation. You wouldn't just have scraps of paper flying all around. If possible, I'll try and do this on a live call with them, whether that's a screen share or a Loom recording if they can't make it live, just so I can walk through the process and say, well, here's why I did this, and here's why I like this, so I can really help them understand how I got there. I think this also helps them feel really connected to the designs and helps them understand your thought process and your expertise, which is why they hired you in the first place. Plus, I like hearing their initial reactions and being able to help guide them as they maybe decide between more than one option or maybe have to make revisions. So before delivering final files, I make sure the invoice is paid, okay? Pay me. Once that invoice is paid, I will make sure everything is labeled and all the layers are clean and organized so they know exactly what to do. Remember, they might not be graphic designers, and if they are, they're going to be real judgy if you open it with seven layers and they're all new layer, new layer, new layer, right? So I make sure everything is really organized and they know exactly how to use the files. I will send those files over via Dropbox or Google Drive and make sure they have everything they need so they don't need to come back for me looking for something that's already in there. I might even do a Loom walkthrough that says, okay, well, your logo files are in here and your this files are here and there and there and there, because I really want to make sure they feel like I took care of them and they know exactly what to do. I want them to feel empowered to use whatever I've delivered to them in whatever way they need to use it. Now, this is my favorite part of the process. Once the project is finalized, they've paid, it's time to celebrate, and I have a couple tricks up my sleeve for this one. I really like to send a thank you. So if this is a humongous project, I'm gonna do something a little extra than I would do for a small, let's say $600 project. I might do something as simple as send a handwritten note, or maybe a custom water bottle with their logo on it, or something that really feels very personal to them and their brand experience and whatever they just launched with me. This is one of the best ways to get referrals, is to really leave your clients on a total high after working with you. One of my clients had a really big launch, and to celebrate, I sent them, I really wanted to send champagne, but I don't think you can just send that in the mail. The internet told me no. So I sent champagne flavored gummies. I sent a nail polish in their brand colors. I had all this cute packaging in it, a thank you note, and a couple other things that just felt like a big celebration in a box. You could do flowers. You could do something really simple. You could embroider a USB with their new logo if you did branding with them. You could pick things in their favorite colors. You could send them a gift card. You could send so many different options. You can never go wrong by just going a little extra. Oh, another idea would be a tote bag with like their, let's say you did a wedding, you could do a tote bag with their initials or their monogram on it. This is like the fun part for me. I get so excited about it. The best part about this is that I feel like you have under-promised and over-delivered. And I don't mean under-promising as in you're not telling them you're going to do a good job. I mean, you kept a few things secret that you didn't tell them you were going to be doing that really surprise and delight them at the end of the day and leave them feeling so good about working with you. Of course, every project will have its challenges and its bumps and its kinks, but with a tight contract like we use in our contract kit and just some knowledge about working custom with clients, you'll be able to navigate that a lot easier. So that's it. I wrap that project up and I move on to the next one. One thing I like to do is whether it's an anniversary or a launch party, I like to mark that date on my calendar, or maybe it's just my client's birthday. I will write that on my calendar so in the following year, I can reach out to them and say happy birthday, or this made me think of you, or happy anniversary. We launched a year ago today. How are things going? And it can really open the door for repeat clients. It's a good idea to follow them on social media or comment on their posts and just cheer them on along their way after they've invested with you. You can be part of their support team and community. I'd love to hear how you over-deliver with clients. I think you can see I get really, really excited about it. So drop a comment below and tell me how you over-deliver with your clients and how you work with them and what your process looks like. If you found this video helpful, share it with a friend, subscribe to our channel so that you can get all new videos about how to grow your art biz. We're artists who mean business, and we're in this with you. Pound it. Go team.